The Unshackled Waves, Episode 26. Hello and welcome to the Unshackled Waves podcast. I'm Tim Wilms. It's time for another interview show. So our guest for today is Australian YouTuber 8-Bit Thoughts, who makes videos related to the culture wars, commentary about the progressive left, as well as informative videos on public policy. His channel now has over 1,000 subscribers and it's been going for around 6 months. So we thought we'd invite 8-Bit on the show today to talk about his YouTube channel, his videos, and politics in general. So 8-Bit, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, mate.
So we'll start talking about your channel to begin with. So describe how you came to create your YouTube channel and what's your ultimate aim with your videos?
Well, I guess it all started probably about 2 years ago when I saw Sam Harris and Ben Affleck on their show sort of having a bit of a chat about Islam and Ben Affleck just completely losing the plot. Now, I watched this with a friend who knew a lot about politics and was explaining how Sam Harris was right. And at the time, I couldn't really swallow that pill. I just saw it as, you know, Islamophobia. But after a couple months of sort of discussing politics and really gaining an understanding into all this sort of stuff, I started swinging a bit further away from the left. And I don't know how I stumbled across Baring's channel. He's another Australian YouTuber who does a lot of comedy stuff. But I basically binge watched his entire channel in the space of about 48 hours. And then I found Sargon of Akkad and binged watch his channel for about a month. And that was sort of my red pilling moment when I realized, holy shit, there is a lot going on in the world and it's all pretty stupid stuff. So I'd been umming and ahhing about starting a YouTube channel, but I'm professional at procrastinating. So it probably took me 6 months before I ever made my first video, and you know, the first three videos no one should ever watch. They're horrendous. Now, it actually started as me just wanting to be able to vent, because I've got a lot of friends who don't really talk about politics at all, and they're just not interested in it. So it was just a way of me, I guess, getting my voice out there. And I sort of kept seeing certain issues pop up that I thought were important, such as, you know, the Racial Discrimination Act and Section 18C, because there's a lot of things that Australians aren't talking about. So my channel does have a big Australian influence, but it's not limited to that. Now, as far as, you know, what my end goal is, I guess it's to educate people effectively, because there's a lot of things out there that no one ever questions. The mainstream media in Australia has just gone full social justice warrior. And because there's no other counter arguments, people are just accepting everything that they see as truth. So I try and give some differing opinions. I try and use a bit of comedy to spice it up where I can, although it's hard sometimes, especially if I'm talking about suicide. And I do a lot of research. I read a lot of statistics and journal articles and all that sort of stuff. So I basically sift through a lot of information and then put it in a simple form for everyone to be able to understand. So, yeah, hopefully it will get bigger so I can, I guess, have a bit more political influence, even if it's at a micro level. But, yeah, I think it's very important because we've had some massive changes over the past decade. And I think we've gone far too far to the left, and we need to start coming back at least to the center, in my opinion.
Yeah, that's interesting that your political conversion was only quite recent. So, yeah, and also, yeah, a lot of people don't realize that to make a YouTube video, I mean, sure, it only goes for about 4 to 5 minutes sometimes, but it takes sort of hours to research these things because if you say one thing that's factually incorrect, then people just dismiss your video.
Exactly. I did a video recently on domestic violence, and the whole video goes for about 13 minutes, but that was 3 weeks of research. I probably read about 400 or 500 pages worth of reports. So that was pretty interesting. But yeah, as it's a lot of energy that goes into it, especially when you're having to sift through statistics and check their citations. Because it's really easy to make the mistake of just looking at a claim and saying, yes, well, this supports what I believe without actually checking it. And that's where a lot of people stuff up. So I try my best to avoid it, but every now and then I still stuff up. It's just nature of the beast.
My next question is, this is sort of my own curiosity, is that so you use the I guess you'd call alias 8-bit thoughts. So why did you decide to remain anonymous?
Well, I wasn't actually planning on remaining anonymous when I first started. Originally, it was just the character, because every time you put me on camera, I have about three brain cells. Turn the camera off and I'm back to normal. I don't know what it is, but it was just, yeah, that was the easier way. But as I got bigger and had a lot more followers, then I started having a few run-ins with feminists and things like that. Now, with people in Australia like Clementine Ford, who just get off on getting people fired, taking people out of context, and all that sort of stuff, I thought it was probably safer for me because I run my own business. And the last thing I want is some feminist dragging me, taking me to the cleaners in the media and just slandering me. So, yeah, the extreme feminists can be quite dangerous people in a sense. They can ruin their people's lives. And given the amount of shit posting that I do on Twitter, it'd be very, very easy to take me out of context. So yeah, it's just to protect my business effectively. But with that said, I think at some time in the future, I'll be a bit more open about who I am. Just I'm not ready to do it quite yet.
It's a bit of a shame that we sort of live in this world where these feminists and social justice warriors could get people fired and shut down people's businesses. I mean, Clementine Ford, she did get a man fired, which was outrageous. For me, I've been politically active for probably about 7 years now, so I'm not afraid to put my name in things. But yeah, for some people, they've got to be a bit more careful.
And it's actually quite sad because I think when you're using a character, it does make, I guess, for good branding. But on the flip side to that, it does make you look like you're trying to hide yourself. And I think that can sometimes take a bit of a take away from the message. I think people have a bit more trust when they've got a face to look at rather than just a voice.
Yeah, I definitely think it's yeah, there is a downside to remaining anonymous, but yeah, a lot of successful YouTubers, they have a lot of them have begun like Sargon of Cardiff, begun anonymously and then eventually revealed themselves, and Baring just did his face reveal, so. I'll move on to my next question now, which is so we mentioned at the beginning that your YouTube channel has now reached over 1,000 subscribers. Now, our the Unshackled YouTube channel, we've got at the time of this podcast, we've got 34 subscribers. So,
It's more than 0.
yeah, but it's incredibly hard to grow a YouTube channel. So what do you think's the key to success on YouTube, would you say?
Okay, so it comes down to three different things, in my opinion. So the first one, and probably the easiest one to get right, is quality of production. So a good quality microphone, if you're using a video camera, make sure it's in HD. when I'm recording my audio, I do my best to apply a noise reduction filter on it, a compressor, just to get the audio really, really crisp, because there's nothing more frustrating than hearing sort of staticky or echoey audio. It just sort of takes away from it a bit. And, you know, just sort of cutting out, you know, little bits here and there. Say, you know, someone knocks on your door, rather than leaving that in, I try and take those things out. So it does take a bit more time and obviously a bit more money. The more money you spend on equipment, the better. But, you know, really, my mic cost me, I think it was $200, and it does the job perfectly. Eventually, I'll move to a condenser mic. I just haven't got around to it yet. Now, the second thing that I see as important is quality of content. Like, it's all well and good to, you know, make a video of someone tripping over and have that be as hilarious, but it's not particularly valuable. So I put a lot of time and effort into writing my scripts and, you know, figuring out what the best way of bringing the message across will be. Try and use humor sort of wherever possible. But, you know, in politics, it's really hard to make humor out of politics sometimes because it can be such a dry topic. But the third and most important, in my opinion, is networking. So when I first started out, I probably got to, I think it was about 40 subscribers, and I just did a video on the Safe Schools program in Victoria, and there was just so much to talk about that I thought, rather than just doing a 15-minute video on it, I'd go and do a live stream to cover the curriculum and go into a lot of detail about it. So I reached out to some YouTubers called Mara Jane, Gary Awesome, and Independent Man. And at the time, Gary and Indy had probably 10,000 subscribers each, and they agreed to jump on. And because, you know, I was providing good value, I was a good host, they shared the stream, and that got me a sort of a massive boost. And then I had another YouTuber called Omegon, who's got about 10,000 subscribers, find my content somehow. And he used some of one of my videos in his, and that took me from 150 to 500 overnight, effectively. And then it's just sort of been growing slowly but surely ever since. So I think whenever you can reach out to other YouTubers that make similar content, you know, make friends with them, not with the intention of taking anything from them, but, you know, just generally getting to know them. And my attitude is I try to give value rather than take value. So, you know, offer to do a guest video for someone else if they're sick, or, you know, give them some information that I've got that they don't, little things like that. And once you build some strong relationships, then you can start doing collaborations with other people, or, you know, interviewing people of a higher caliber and all that sort of stuff, because you've got a better reputation. So, yeah, networking for me has just been the most important part of YouTube.
Yeah, I'd certainly agree with that. I mean, the Unshackled, we're friends with all of the other alternative media bloggers in Australia and regularly share stuff with each other. So yeah, certainly I would agree that yeah, networking is a big part of growing. For us, yeah, like I said at the beginning, YouTube has been a bit more difficult, though we have mastered Facebook, which is good. So one social media platform at a time for us. Now, I would describe your channel as part of the anti-social justice warrior crowd of YouTubers. Now, there's probably about hundreds or thousands of them, and they all seem to do pretty well. So why do you think these anti-SJW YouTubers are so popular?
Well, with the changes that's happened in politics over the past 20 years, the left has gained power, and a lot of power. And one of the classic tactics of the left is to label people if they don't agree. So you're a bigot, you're a racist, you're Islamophobe, homophobe, you know, it's just buzzword central. And, you know, people don't want to be called a racist, so they stay quiet. And now that some people on YouTube have started fighting back against it, I think it's sort of giving people a voice. You know, there's people on YouTube are saying things that you can't really say in public without being ostracized. I mean, coming out of, as a conservative is the new coming out as gay. So I think that's why it's been popular. And I also think it's because a lot of them are using humor as well to put the message across. And it really, really is entertaining. And because it's done with humor, I think people are able to swallow it a lot better. But I'm not sure if the anti-SJW crowd will grow on YouTube. I think it might be coming pretty close to a limit purely because of how many people are doing it. Like, even since I started, there's been hundreds of little channels I've seen pop up. So, yeah, I just don't know if there's a big enough audience to support the entire anti-SJW community or lack, or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, yeah, I'd certainly agree with that, because there's just so many of them, and whenever one of these SJW releases a video, I think I come across about 20 at least responsive videos. But I think it does certainly show that there is a backlash against sort of this politically correct madness that you can't say certain thing, and just an embrace of free speech again.
Yeah, yeah. And I've sort of tried to avoid doing a lot of these response videos, because I find it's often just I'm repeating the same arguments. I'm not coming up with anything new. And I think it just gets tiresome. Like, they're boring videos for me to make, unless Riley comes out and says something completely fucking stupid. Sorry, am I allowed to swear on this?
I prefer you not, but if you do, it's not the end of the world. Yeah.
Okay, so if Riley says something completely stupid that she sort of hasn't said in the I'm not sure which pronoun she is. If she says something that is just completely ridiculous that she hasn't said 20 times over, then I'll respond to that. But, yeah, I do find that when, you know, these sort of SJW kids release a video, my subscription list is, you know, 50 response videos.
Yeah, we might talk about now that these response videos to SJW YouTubers, yeah, they are quite common among the anti-SJW crowd. So you mentioned Riley Dennis, and there's also, of course, Milo Stewart, Lacey Green, and, of course, Black Hitler. My follow-up question to you is, do you think that these people are real, or they must be satirists like Cobber Cab is?
Look, I really, really want to believe it, but yeah, I don't. I would love nothing more than for Riley J. Dennis to come out and say, I was just trolling you guys.
Yeah, I would love that. I would just be... Because it would really just ruin all the people who actually take them seriously. It would just ruin their world.
I mean, this generation of millennials have been brought up by overprotective parents. We've had government regulation increase to the point that, you know, they don't want you to fall over and scrape your knee type thing. So, yeah, they've just been wrapped in bubble wrap, effectively, their whole lives. They've never had anything bad happen to them, and they haven't been exposed to any different opinions. So when they hear an opinion that's not of their own, they think that it's hate speech. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, they're putting these YouTube is a public forum, so obviously they're putting it out to the public and getting all these comments. I would have thought that, you know, they would read some of those comments and sort of reflect on, you know, is my political position that correct? Should I, you know, reconsider? But they just seem to keep going along and say even more crazy things.
Yeah, I mean, the level of narcissism is just ridiculous. The fact that they can receive so much criticism and every single video have an incredible amount of dislikes that they're just so full of themselves that they think they couldn't possibly be wrong.
But I think they should read because they've all got Encyclopedia Dramatica entries. I wonder if they've read those. but yeah, it's sometimes I think that they deliberately say things because they know that people just think they're crazy.
Yeah, I do wonder about that because there's a YouTuber called Ashley Mardell. And she's been on YouTube for a while, and apparently when her channel was first growing, all of her content was really, you know, just normal and it was fine. But now she's gone full social justice warrior. She's just exploded in popularity. So, yeah, I guess there's a case to make for, you know, there might be some incentive there. I mean, if you look at Anthony Mundine, for example, he goes out of his way to make people hate him because it makes money. You know, more people will go to that boxing match to see him get punched in the face. So he's made a career out of people hating him. And I think there's a possibility that some of these YouTubers are doing exactly the same thing. They're just saying these ridiculously controversial ideas and, you know, potentially pretending to believe this stuff when they don't. But yeah, I don't know. I just can't sort of accept that they're all just trolls and making money. I mean, they're just too good at it. If they are, I would take my hat off to them because I would never have guessed it.
Maybe one day we'll find out. So you described your political conversion, but how would you best describe your political philosophy? Would you classify yourself as a conservative or libertarian? How would you describe your views?
Well, according to feminists, I'm a Nazi. But I'm really not a big fan of labels because anytime you say you're a conservative or a libertarian is people tend to put you on the extreme end of that. So they would then assume I'm against gay marriage, I want babies to die, you know, I'm a Christian, all that sort of stuff. So I consider myself right-leaning and libertarian-leaning. Like, as much of a libertarian as I am, I'm not full anarcho-cap type, you know, believe in no government. I think we should have a small government, but not no government at all. I believe in low taxation, but not no taxation, even though that would benefit me immensely. And when it comes to issues like gay marriage and abortion rights, then, you know, I'd definitely be on the left for those. So, yeah, it really just depends on what the policy is. But yeah, right-leaning, libertarian-leaning.
Yeah, it's certainly interesting that or sort of this these new generation of people have become active in politics against the left and social justice warriors. They are hard to classify as conservative or libertarian. I mean, there's also the label alt-right as well, but even that's got some negative connotation to it as well. I'd sort of more describe it as a bit more reactionary. It's people who weren't engaged in politics, just wanted to live their lives, but are just seeing the left, you know, interfere with their lives, and so they're only getting involved, you know, reacting to this threat from the left.
Yeah, definitely.
So let's talk specifically about a few of your videos. Now, they tend to focus on Australian issues, and you did a 3-video series on the Australian political landscape going through our various problems. So how do you think we got into this current situation in Australia? You know, where did we go wrong?
That's a really, really good question. I mean, the problem we've had in politics, things like politicians not being honest with everyone, flip-flopping on their policies, you know, one minute we've got a carbon tax, the next minute we don't, you know, one politician will say, yep, we're going to implement this once I get voted in, and then they don't do it. So, you know, we never really know what's happening. And politicians never, ever answer questions. But it's amazing. It doesn't matter how many times you ask it, they will manage to avoid it every single time. But I think we've had those problems for a very, very long time. I don't think that's got any better or worse. I think it's just the nature of politics, unfortunately, which is why I like people like David Lynham, because they're honest. And same with Pauline Hanson as well. I think the biggest change that we've had has been in the media and academia. So if you go back to the 90s, or around the mid-90s was when it really, really flipped. That was when, like, if you look at the studies, the left overwhelmingly control universities. And at the same time, we had this shift in culture, which really, really moved towards sensationalism. We had the rise of reality TV, you know, all that sort of stuff. So if you look at a show like 60 Minutes in Australia, 20 years ago, that was really, really good investigative journalism. Whereas now it's just, you know, this is why you shouldn't feed your baby this water because it got this in it. You know, just stupid, stupid stuff. Interviews with celebrities. And since the media, you know, is inherently left-wing, what used to be really, really good, hard-hitting journalist stuff has just turned into social justice. If you look at the ABC, for example, they used to be a very, very good source of news, whereas now it's just absolute rubbish. Every second day they're putting out an article talking about the gender pay gap in sport, which is a problem of just basic economics. It's got nothing to do with sexism. So, yeah, I think with the rise of the left in the 90s and the changes we had in the media and education is what got us here.
Yeah, it's certainly, from what I see it, the media is responsible for a lot of this, especially, the ABC and Fairfax, and sort of it's made our politicians afraid to speak honestly. If they say something that's not politically correct or not of an acceptable opinion, there's immediately an article saying how terrible their view is. They should apologize to these people that they've offended. They'll get some person from some human rights organization or social services lobby saying, oh, you know, how dare they propose this? And then they say, the politicians, oh, sorry, oh, we're not going to do this, or we're going to, that's the reason why we're getting, you know, no substantial, like, obviously the Australian budget's in terrible shape, and we are seeing things such as free speech and the nanny state continue to take away our liberties. So, yeah, and academia, I think that the reason they're only empowered because the media puts them as the experts. So I think definitely, I think the media is probably the main problem here.
Well, if you want any conservative news in Australia, the only way you can get it is by paying a subscription to Foxtel to get Sky News, or to pay a subscription to something like The Australian. But, you know, we do have some journalists who are coming out swinging, people like Miranda Devine, Mark Latham, Chris Kennedy, Rita Panini, all these sorts of people who are doing some really, really good work. But, yeah, they're just slowly gaining popularity. I just think we're still a while away from a big shift again.
But even, I think, News Corp, which is most people consider conservative, I mean, even they're still afraid to sort of put out a certain news. I mean, if you take, for example, the Bourke Street car attack, it was, I mean, the reason why people were like speculating that it was terrorism, for example, is because we weren't getting any information from the police, the government, or the media themselves. So that's why you had a lot of citizen journalists and alternative media such as ours, you know, going through the interviews and the perpetrator's Facebook page just to see what actually was going on.
Yeah. And, you know, these sorts of attacks are generally coming from one particular demographic. So I don't think it's unreasonable for people to assume. We've just got to make sure that we get it right. But yeah, the media need to be more open and honest about this sort of stuff. So, you know, we're not ending up having riots over a religion when it wasn't even that religion that caused it. So yeah, I do think we need to be careful, but we need to be honest.
Yeah. And I definitely think that, yeah, the public, they are now starting to wake up to the fact that the media is not telling them the truth and is misleading them on a lot of key issues.
What I found hilarious was that I think it was either the CNN or the Guardian have stopped using the term fake news. Like, even though they created it, everyone's using it against them because CNN and The Guardian are the fake news. So, yeah, it's kind of bitten them in the ass. I thought that was brilliant.
Yeah. Well, because everyone points out all of the fake news that they've put out and turned it on them. And I think it was the Washington Post that said, oh, we shouldn't use the term anymore. So we have seen some pushback against the left and political correctness around the world. Obviously, the election of Donald Trump, that's really changed things in the United States. But in Australia, it's still... We've got the Labor Party, which is so far to the left now, but we've also got in the Liberal Party being led by a left-wing Prime Minister. So how do you think that Australians can fight back, given that we are in this, I guess you'd call it a political despairing situation?
I think we can fight back. But it's got to start with education. Now, I'm not saying that most Australians are stupid. I'm just that we haven't really been taught a lot of critical thinking. And we also haven't been taught about the morality of politics. Like, we've all heard of socialism. We've all heard of communism, capitalism, all this sort of stuff. But people don't really understand what it actually means. So... when someone says socialism, they think, you know, libraries and healthcare, for example, as opposed to really understanding that Marx was about removing all classism and seizing the means of production. people seem to have forgotten about history. If you look at what happened in the Russian Revolution, for example, in, was it 1917 or 1919, when the Bolsheviks came into power, they overthrew the royal family. And the Bolsheviks came into power with overwhelming support. And, you know, they were quite authoritarian. And, you know, once Lenin died and Stalin came in, it became totalitarian. And that all happened in a very, very short amount of time. So, you know, when we see people on the left pushing for these super authoritarian laws, they don't realize what the consequences of that can be. Now, I'm not saying that the introduction in the Safe Schools program is going to lead to gulags, but, you know, that's how you get down to that path, is, you know, by just increasing authority. And if it's left unchecked, it can be very dangerous. So if people can get an understanding into the morality of freedoms and why small government is important, and they understand that debate is healthy, until we reach that point in time, I really don't think we're going to get anywhere. But with that said, once that happens, if it happens, then we can start debating. We don't all need to agree, but we need to have debating. Because at the moment, anytime someone wants to have a discussion about something, it's all bigot, racist, Islamophobe. So if we want to talk about immigration in Australia, we need to have an honest debate. Is there a risk to Australia of domestic terrorism as a result of changes in our immigration policy? That the left aren't willing to have that conversation. So it's frustrating, but it is also changing. So people, as the left become more extreme, people tend to wake up a bit more. If you look at what happened with Pauline Hanson, she made a comeback of a century. I don't think anyone saw how much of a big comeback she would make. And the left's response to that was, wow, we have a lot of racists in our country, which is exactly what the problem. I mean, that type of attitude is what got Hanson elected. Now, we've got a state election, I think, coming up. I think it's either this year or next year.
Which state is this?
Queensland.
Yep.
There's a lot of LNP party members that are jumping ship and joining with One Nation. So it looks like One Nation might get quite a few seats in Australia, in Queensland Parliament. And then we've got people like David Leinhelm from the Liberal Democrats Party. Whilst they've only got one senator, another guy named Gabe, who I actually met, he very, very closely won a seat in the federal election, but lost out just due to the preferences. So, you know, with them making changes and speaking out against the extremism of the left, and obviously not everyone on the left is like this, but it's the ones who speak the loudest that make the biggest difference. You know, media outlets like yourself, alternative media, I think is really, really important, and I think that's gaining popularity. Like, I noticed you guys have, is it 2,500 likes on Facebook?
As of this recording, I think we're about 2,650, so yeah.
Yeah, so that's really good. I mean, I can't remember how I found your stuff, but yeah, I instantly followed it and I really enjoy it, and I'll share it with where possible, because I think more people need to be exposed to different ideas rather than living in this echo chamber that we seem to be in Australia. And, you know, then you've got shitlords like me who are making videos, speaking up, you know, whilst we may not... And most of my audience is actually American, but you know, we've had Americans start talking to other Australians on Twitter and say, hey, what's going on with you guys? So I think it is shifting slowly, but I think it's going to get worse before it gets better. And I kind of think that's a good thing. So I'll explain why. The more ridiculous the left become, the better. Because that way, people wake up and go, holy hell, these guys are absolutely insane. If you look at what happened in the United States, today, I think it was at Berkeley, Milo Yiannopoulos went to speak, who's a gay Jew immigrant, but he's a conservative. So we had Antifa or anti-fascist groups not only protest against him, but riot against him. They were burning things, you know, riot squads had to be called in. We heard cases of Milo supporters being pepper sprayed or maced. It's just ridiculous. But this happening is really important, because when we put that stuff on the news and say, yep, this is bad, this is what's going on, I think people will say, okay, the left needs reforming. And I really, really do hope that the right don't behave like this, because I think if we drop to that level, that'll be almost the nail in the coffin for the right, because there's no way the left would ever let the right get away with that. So, yeah, I think, and the other thing is, like, leftists tend to eat themselves alive, because if you're not lefting correctly, you'll be ousted. If you look at feminist Christina Hoff Summers, really, really incredible, super intelligent woman. She's been fighting for feminism since the 60s. You know, she was at protests. She was fighting for equal pay to get women into the workforce. She was fighting for genuinely good things. But now when she says third wave feminism has gone too far, she's become public enemy number one for feminists. So, you know, hopefully, is feminists just get to a point where you say the slightest different thing, you get kicked out of the group, and then little bit by little bit, there's no more feminists left. I look forward to that day.
Yeah, I definitely would agree that, yeah, you can try and educate people as much as possible, but a lot of people, they're not interested in politics, they just want to live their day-to-day lives. But so you have to get to a stage of crisis, which we're beginning to see now, for people to actually wake up and take notice, and then the years that you've sort of spent, you know, putting out videos or books, then people will start to turn to those and say, yes, this is correct. This is the solution that we need.
Mm. And you make a good point about people not taking notice. Because a lot of people don't understand liberty and freedoms and all that sort of stuff, the general consensus is, oh, well, it doesn't affect me. Well, it does affect you. I mean, you can now get a fine for leaving your car unlocked. It's just tiny little law. I think I heard something along the lines of 6,000 new laws each year are implemented. And it's not happening at an alarming rate where, you know, we're going to be a totalitarian government within 5 years. But we've seen the increase of the nanny state with lockout laws. And they've done absolutely nothing to reduce violence. So, yeah, hopefully things start changing soon.
Especially with the nanny state, I find it weird in Australia, the fact that Australians like to, you know, drink, party, do a lot of fun things, yet they don't seem to notice that the government is passing all these nanny state laws that restricts all of those activities.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's sort of one thing that's concerned me about this is happening, but the public aren't waking up. But I hope that that'll eventually change.
In Queensland, I don't think there's a single person that supports our lockout laws. Because when Anastasia Palaszczuk, who's the premier here, came into power, that was not one of her policies. It was only implemented after she came in. Now, apparently they're looking at repealing it. Or at least driving it back a little bit. Because if she doesn't, she will lose the millennial vote, 100%.
Yeah, and there is huge pressure on the new Premier of New South Wales to relax their lockout laws now that Mike Baird's resigned. So, it's pretty much we have to cross our fingers and hope that politicians listen to us, which is never a good way to live.
Yeah, exactly.
So I might ask you a bit in detail. Like we talk about the left's agenda and their how their ideas are harmful, but I'd just like to talk about them specifically. So why do you think, in your own words, why is feminism such a threat to freedom, the Safe Schools program in Australia, and also Islamism?
Sort of a complex topic, so I'm not really sure where to start. I guess the biggest problem with these ideologies is it's just identity politics. And rather than bringing everyone together and, you know, saying, yep, we're all different people, we're all individuals, but, you know, we're still all human, They're dividing us further, and they're taking us back to segregation. I mean, there's a Aboriginal-only computer lab in QUT, which is a university here in Queensland. Like, segregation seems to be becoming popular again, which is the very thing that we were fighting against in the 50s and 60s. like Martin Luther King would be rolling over in his grave. But the biggest problem with feminism is their silencing tactics. So you're a racist, you're an Islamophobe, you know, so on and so forth. And as a result, they've just created such an echo chamber that their ideas are getting more toxic, more dangerous. You know, we're having like the hashtag kill all men is starting to come out. You know, there's just this giant narrative, and I'm going to have to swear, so if anyone's listening, just be ready. Fuck white people, basically. And we've, like, if a white person were to call a black person the N-word, and everyone would jump on that. We'd be going, no, that is not tolerated in modern day society. We've been through this. But now it's okay to do it to white men. And I think that's a really, really dangerous attitude. And when you're vilifying an entire class of people for what their genetics are, as opposed to what their ideas are, you're going to create a group of people that are going to hate you a lot. And I think if we have a lot of hateful men towards women because of how they've been treated for an entire upbringing, it's going to lead to some very, very dangerous consequences, I think. I don't know what those consequences will be, but when it comes to the Safe Schools program, the biggest problem I have with it, apart from it teaching the kids identity politics, and there's even part of the curriculum that boys in high school have to acknowledge that they've got toxic masculinity. I mean, if we raise a generation of boys who are being taught that they are bad because they have a willy, they're going to grow up either extremely hateful or extremely broken. And I can't think of many things more dangerous than that. Because when they go through their lives, they're going to be running on a lot of anger and resentment. And if you put enough anger and resentment into people, they start doing bad things. And that's not a world I want to live in. It's not a world we should live in. I think the Safe Schools program is effectively child abuse, in my opinion.
Yeah. Oh, I certainly agree with that, but I always, like, when I'm interviewing people such as yourself, I always like to get them to explain in their own words about why these sorts of identity politics are harmful. We've run out of time for today, so thank you, 8-Bit, for being a guest on today's show.
Thank you very much for having me, mate. I really enjoyed it.
And of course, I would advise all of our listeners to go and subscribe to his YouTube channel and check out some of his videos that we discussed today. And we wish you all the best, 8-Bit, and keep up the good work, and hope your channel continues to grow, and I'm sure we'll keep in touch.
Yeah, thanks. Have a good one.
All right, that's the show for today. I'll be back next week for another review show. So news is, well, it's now coming in rapidly at the moment, so there's so much to talk about now. Don't forget to sign up to our email list at theunshackled.net/subscribe. Don't forget to visit the support section of our website to consider supporting the show. And also, don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, or view the video version on YouTube. So thanks once again for listening, and I'll see you next time.